Vegan.
One, two.
Free.
Right, here we go. We are back. This is Sound Art Radio, and I'm here, not in the studio, with our host, Bertie Justice. How you doing, Bertie?
I'm good. Yourself?
Yeah, mate, I'm not too bad.
Cool. The sort of the running theme that I was thinking for today is we're going to talk about meanings and truth. And sort of the subtleties that language can implement, and sort of the connotations and the thinking that we have when we're presented with words and ideas, and like focusing on the truth, because like a fable or like a lie, you can say anything and you can sort of you can control what people think. So if once people learn the truth, then they can make up their own minds. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for sure.
So we'll be, and also we've got quite a few we've got a few beatbox tracks today, and we've got lots of interesting topics to talk about.
So where do you want to kick off?
I mean, the big one that's sort of happened recently is that this will sort of be sort of the running theme for today, is that there is currently legislation and court proceedings being pushed through, and it's basically called, it's been labelled cultural hijacking. Essentially what's happened is that some people have got the term burger and sausage and steak are, some people, they come from the animal agriculture industry, they believe that they own that word.
So this is what's going through the European Parliament at the moment, the Veggie Burger Bill, as it's been named.
Yeah, I mean, it's got a more technical term, but essentially that's what it is. It's the veggie burger is like the umbrella term, and it means that I've got lots of details about it, but one of them is that essentially the reason they want to take ownership of the word is because they don't want to see consumers getting confused by the word burger. If it says veggie burger, they want people to not be confused by the fact that it's a veggie burger, not a meat burger. And the data shows that less than 4% of all consumers ever get confused. And my point to this is that I've bought something, I've got confused before. I bought some oats and they had some honey in, and I didn't read the label properly because it was small print. But the reality is I'll never buy that again. If I was, do you know what I mean? I was genuinely confused. I will never buy it again. It seems very strange. And there's a lot of other bigger things going on in the world than if people get confused in a supermarket.
So, I mean, I've been following this a little bit this week, and I do find it quite unusual because it's obviously quite controversial, even within the European Parliament, because what I first read was that the decision was going to go to a vote on Tuesday, and we're here now at Friday. I was researching this quite late last night, and there doesn't seem to have been any official decision made. But what I do know, and what I'm sure you know as well, is that the precedent for this was set 3 years ago, in that we know that we can't talk about products like vegan cheese or vegan yogurt or like soya milk. It can't be called soya milk. It's now called soya drink. But I mean, obviously, as vegans, vegetarians, we all call it soya milk.
In the UK, when this came out in the UK, what I read from the Parliament website is that they disregarded this. This was in like 2019. They disregarded the idea. They said no, that doesn't make any sense. And also, it gets a bit deeper in that the government push is to get people to eat more and more plant based because it has a lower carbon footprint, and it causes less greenhouse gases. So it goes contrary to what the environmental idea is. You know, the environmental project is to get people to eat less meat and animal products because they cause such environmental degradation. If we're going to this idea, this veggie burger ban, contradicts that. It makes more people buy those products.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the argument that's being used to counteract this bill at the moment, isn't it, within the European Parliament? From various vegan vegetarian lobbyist groups, I guess.
Interestingly, I've got a few friends around the world, and they've actually let me know that it's part of Europe and it's happening in Canada and other parts of the world, and so it's not just a European thing. But the craziness is like, how far is it going to go? Are they going to stop us calling other products that sound like animal products as well? You know what I mean? We've got coconut milk, we've got hot dogs. They don't have any dogs in them. Do you know what I mean? If we're going to go down to the semantics, and for those that don't know, semantics means the meanings and the meanings of words.
I think as vegans, vegetarians, we can actually take a lot of heart from this action. We can see here that the meat industry are genuinely worried about the direction of travel, and that's a good thing. Since the legislation came in that stopped people talking about vegan cheese, that stopped people talking about soya milk, the number of vegan vegetarian products has increased, the number of vegan vegetarian consumers have increased, and I mean, I think it's a given, really, to use a colloquialism, that the meat industry, with trying to bring in legislation like this, they're terrified, they're panicking, and they're weeing into the wind, as it were. You know, they are losing, I think.
Yeah, I think that might be a point of desperation. Do you know what I mean? This sounds to me like people who are desperate. They're desperate to do whatever they can, and the truth within that is that when people are desperate and they're frantic, they become more and more crazy and strange, their ideas. You know what I mean? If they're trying to take away the meaning of a word so that some consumers don't get confused, it seems desperate and mental to me. And you're right, it is an absolute sign that they're like, okay, so we can't get people to eat meat by their current means, because obviously the sales of plant-based foods are increasing. So they're like, okay, what other methods can we take? And the reality is that people aren't stupid. Do you know what I mean? Even let's go down the hypothetical that they do bring in this legislation. Human beings who know that animal products kill animals and they think it's weird and it doesn't make any sense, they're still going to buy products that say veggie disc or veggie cylinder. You know what I mean? I personally, when I'm buying it, I buy it for the taste. I'm not that bothered by the wording.
Well, quite. I mean, you know, and you know, of course, you know, branding is more than the word. So as far as soya milk goes, I'm sure I probably used to buy soya milk. When they changed the packaging to soya drink, I can't honestly say that I even noticed, because everything else on the packet and the branding would have been identical.
I'm literally going to pull one up now, because I'm trying to think, because I've got almond, and I didn't even realise that I am one of those people that didn't even realise they changed it, because I've got some almond milk in front of me and it just says almond on the front. That's new news to me, that I didn't even realise they had changed it, and the reality is that it hasn't affected my life in any way.
Yeah, I mean, this is an extension of, you know, legislation that went through the European Parliament, I think 3 years ago now, which was about, about branding of dairy products. So cheese things can't be called cheese, yogurt things can't be called yogurt, and milky things can't be called milk. but in terms of its real-term effect on people eating a vegetarian, vegan lifestyle, vegetarian, vegan diet, it's made no difference at all, and it probably has had a barely perceptible impact on the market, which, as we both know, is growing considerably, and has grown considerably in the last 3 years. So, I will notice that I'm eating a veggie tube for about, you know, a third of a second, and then I'll just carry on enjoying my veggie tube. I'll probably call it a sausage.
Well, that's the thing, is like, you know, are we gonna get arrested if we ask for a veggie burger? Or, you know what I mean? Like, where's it gonna stop? It's very it's very weird. That's my like genuine view, is that it's very weird and sort of restrictive to use a word or a term when it's when no one really owns the term burger. And where did the term burger come from? Is it copyrighted? Is it trademarked? Do you know what I mean? It's a very strange strange thing that's happening.
It is. I mean, you know, I'm interested to see which way the European Parliament will go, because obviously it was quite weird 3 years ago that they changed the legislation around sort of milk and dairy product. And I think the conversation has become a lot more animated since then. And coming back to all those things you were talking about with regards to having an impact on
the environment,
They could look, you know, it could reflect quite badly on the European Parliament in some way. You know, they're already under considerable scrutiny from the environmental left, shall we say, or even, you know, or
just the agencies in general.
Because they've just, you know, thrown huge amounts of money towards the Common Agricultural Policy, which supports industrialised farming, for example. And a lot of people are quite unhappy about that. I think that was Greta Thunberg's latest rally against the European Parliament this week, her latest speech, if you noticed that.
I haven't seen that one yet. I'll have to check that out.
The point being that in terms of its response to climate and the environment, they are under scrutiny for the money that they, you know, billions of dollars, billions of euros, should I say, that go towards supporting unhealthy and environmentally unsound industrialised farming practices.
Yeah, I did see some of the articles that I saw, like an element of it, they were saying, like, the Impossible Burger or the Beyond Burger has more fat in than a normal burger. But that's what they're doing, is they are cherry picking the information they want to talk about. So if we compare a animal burger to a veggie burger in general, okay, maybe there is more fat in it, but the veggie burger will never have any cholesterol or any animal cholesterol. It'll have a lot less animal hormones. And then you move on to things like fish. I bought some fake fish the other day. Maybe I'm not allowed to say tuna anymore. Basically, I bought this tuna in a can and made some vegan tuna mayonnaise sandwiches.
Ah, okay. So, I mean, have you ever? You must have had like a tin of braised tofu.
Yes. So it's basically that, but a little bit more technology that's added into it and made it more sort of tuna-like.
Mixing a bit of crumbled seaweed, for example.
Exactly, yeah. Well, that's a really fascinating thing, is that people go like, oh, I love the taste of fish, and it's, well, actually, no, what you really love is you love the taste of the sea, because the sea and the seaweed, you know, seaweed tastes like fish.
Yeah, excuse me. Quite. I mean, I've always kind of faked a tuna fish sandwich with, yeah, braised tofu, bit of seaweed, mustard, mayonnaise, vegan mayo, obviously.
Yeah, and then a couple of, like, maybe some salad, maybe some cucumber or...
Yeah, that stuff too.
Yeah. And so I realised that I sort of deviated, but the point is, if you compare the tin of tuna that I bought, sorry, vegan tuna, compared to the tuna that came out of the sea, what happens is that animals bioaccumulate. So they bioaccumulate plastics and metals and heavy metals. So the small animals eat a little bit of metal, and then because we put so many toxins into the sea, what the animals are doing is they are bioaccumulating it in their bodies, and then we're eating that. We're eating the PCBs, which is plastic. We're eating mercury. We're eating other heavy metals, and so it is a two-way street. If we're going to compare the health qualities of a cow burger compared to a veggie burger, we have to look at the full spectrum.
Yeah, for sure. That's a lovely word, bioaccumulating. I hadn't heard that before.
It's just what happens, you know. If you literally, for those that are listening now, Google PCBs and mercury in fish, and it's just another reason not to eat animal products. And I mean, I always bring it back to the fact that these are sentient individuals as well. So unfortunately, what we're doing is we're discussing about the products, you know, the products of a veggie burger versus the cow burger. But it is actually an individual that lost their life, as well as we're talking about the environmental impacts and the health impacts. We have to include the fact that that was an individual. And I think I've mentioned it before, but I think it's very easy for us to forget about those extra individuals. And the thing about health is that I feel that we should all be conscientious about our health, be careful about what we eat, and eat responsibly. But when we're talking about animal products, we really have to sort of dig a little bit deeper, because no one... I've had quite a lot of people talk about soya. Have you ever heard people saying that soya has estrogen in it, Chris?
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that was... I feel like, as someone who's, you know, eaten predominantly vegan vegetarian diet for a long time, certainly when I started... going back to the early 90s, soya chunks, soya mince were quite a staple within a vegan vegetarian household. And then there seemed to be a point, I think, from maybe sort of 2005 onwards, where it felt like soya mince and soya chunks and those kind of products were disappearing from shops, or they were being rebranded very high end. It was much harder to get the dried stuff, and there were a lot of stories, yeah, about it was estrogen. And it felt, I think, to anybody who was thoughtful, it felt like a scare tactic, because soya is very much a principal part of an Asian diet still. So it didn't kind of ring true, but the narrative still, even pre Facebook, still seemed to gain quite a lot of prominence.
Yeah, demonized it. That's what's sort of jumping out at me, is that it could be demonized.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's unusual, you know, to have these kind of conflicts. But yeah, it was very strange. I remember it happening.
Yeah, so from my perspective, so many people have said to me, that soya has estrogen in it, and it does. It absolutely does. It has phytoestrogens, which is a plant estrogen.
Mm-hmm.
And from my research, currently, soya is not a problem. So there's lots of studies saying that it's not a health problem. But the reality is that dairy products have lots of estrogen in them, and they're animal estrogens, and these have been proven to be detrimental to humans. So for those people that are cautious about or worried about estrogen in soy, but maybe they do their own research and their own research says that soy is unhealthy, then they need to maintain the same scrutiny, the same scrutiny of milk and dairy, because they have animal hormones, they have steroids in them. So even the free range local organic dairy cows have to have a certain amount of annual injections of steroids and hormones. So what you'll get, it's the reality is that yes, be skeptical and do your own research about soy. And if you find, I personally, my research has said, what I've seen, it says that it is healthy and it's fine. But if you find something else that I haven't, that you do need to maintain and be consistent, and then go, okay, well, if I'm worried about estrogen in soy, then I should be really worried about estrogen in cow's milk. And then you go down the biological route and you're like, what is cow's milk designed for? Well, it's made by an adult cow for a child calf. And then you do like a little sort of test on yourself and you go, am I a baby calf? No, I'm not. Okay, so that milk is probably not biologically designed for me to eat. And then you go on to how long have we been consuming dairy, and it's about 10 to 12,000 years. And then you go a bit further and then you look at how, I've mentioned it before, but how many millions and millions and a huge percentage of the world population, around 65% of the world population, are lactose intolerant.
Yeah.
So what I try to advise is that people do hold a cynicism, and if you are, you know, interested in the estrogens, or you're worried about the estrogens in soy, you need to hold it true to all the things that you consume, not just the one vegan thing.
Do you have any idea where the sort of story about estrogen in soy products came from? I mean, nowadays, it is, you know, the word you used was demonize, and a term that people use quite offensively, you know, is soy boy, as though, you know, eating vegetarian products makes you soft and things like that, you know. So, and it does come with a slightly conservative alt-right narrative.
Yes, yeah, it's slightly derogative. You consume soy, therefore you're like, what's it called? The opposite to masculine, feminine. And do you know what I mean? There's lots of like notions of that. The roots of it, I'm not aware of, but it kind of reminds me of, I always had this belief that protein comes from meat.
Right, yeah.
And I had this narrative. There was no strain, there was no origin. It just appeared. When I was a child, I used to look at my food I was eating, and I was like, how much protein is in that? And, oh, okay, I haven't got any meat on my plate today, so I that's where I need to get it from. And it's a little bit like the old, I kind of categorize them in the myths and the fables and the fairy tales that we get told. So another one would be, I was told that if I didn't eat my greens, I wouldn't get curly hair as a kid. And I'm sure as we're talking, Chris, you'll be able to think of others that might have appeared, but the reality is that as an adult, I've eaten loads. I love broccoli. At the moment, I've got a thing about broccoli where I'll just steam a whole head of broccoli and I'll just eat that, and then put a little bit on the side of whatever else I'm eating. But I really love greens.
Yeah.
And I've eaten a lot of greens in the last 35 years. And my hair is straight as a ruler.
It is, mate. Yeah, you're obviously not eating enough.
And the other classic is that carrots make you see in the dark. You heard that one?
I had thought that I had read, possibly incorrectly, that there was a modicum of truth in that. Only in so much that I can't remember. Go on. Tell me.
I know. So basically, I'm one of those people that you'll say something or somebody else will say something, and if I don't believe that it's true, I'm like, I'm interested in that. So the reality is that carrots have a mineral or a vitamin called carotene in.
Mm-hmm.
Carotene is good for your eyes, and it's good for lots of things in your body. So that's where it might have started.
Yep, that sounds about right.
Another kind of, maybe it's a myth, maybe it's not, is that oranges have vitamin C in them. And the sort of the myth, or we don't know where it came from, but the idea is that just after the war, they wanted to sell lots of oranges. So they said that oranges had vitamin C, even though because we wanted to increase some trade with the rest of Europe, even though things like guava have more vitamin C in them.
I mean, oranges do contain vitamin C. It's just that the level of vitamin C is comparable to a lot of other fruits. Is that right?
Say that one again.
So oranges do contain vitamin C, but the level of vitamin C they contain is comparable to a lot of other fruits and vegetables.
Exactly. Yeah. So what we've had is you know, notions, myths, fairy tales. But what happens is, as human beings, we take these on as truth. And, you know, unless somebody tells you that dairy also has animal estrogen in, unless you hear that, for the other 50, whatever, you know, my grandparents, they probably have never heard that animal products, or they never really considered that milk has estrogen in it. But when you would mention soy, they would be like, oh no, that's bad.
Yeah.
Does that mean? Yeah. So it's, but the reality is that we're so lucky. Us people who are alive with computers and the way that information is shared at the moment and knowledge, is that these myths, these notions, these fairy tales, they just disappear. They absolutely disappear. I mean, one that's jumping out at me is the food chain. Have you ever had people discussing that with you, Chris?
Well, probably not for a long time, but
yeah.
Tell me your thoughts on food chains.
Well, I mean, what I was thinking is because we've been going for a bit. We'll pull up a track and then we'll discuss the food chain, if that's good with you.
Yep, that's good for me. What do you fancy?
Let's go for it's called Only Human, and it's by Stamina MC and Dub Effects. It's quite a loud one, so maybe just have a look at the peaks as it's playing through.
Yeah, it's quite a long one as well, so maybe I'll fade it out. Standout Radio 102.5 FM. It's the Vegan 123 show with me and your host, Bertie Vegan Justice, remote from Newton Abbot this morning. And I'm stuck here in Buckfastly broadcasting to you, the lovely people of Totnes and Dartington and around the world. That was Only Human, Dub FX and Stamina MC. I like that. That was banging.
Yeah, it's good, isn't it? Yeah, yeah. I've got quite a lot of the music today will be sort of beatbox, instrumental, kind of like inspired.
Good.
And one of the tracks I will be playing is actually one of the ones that I've created myself.
Oh, yeah. Look forward to that. That's a little bit of beatboxing, because we know that you're a secret beatbox enthusiast. We've chatted about Beardy Man, haven't we, in the past?
I've actually got some of his music to play today as well, so music is kind of like a broad term, but yeah, it's going to be good.
Cool, see how we get on.
So before we played Only Human, we were just sort of discussing about the food chain.
Ah, yeah, that's right, yeah.
And again, this is one of those kind of like folklore myths, kind of like unusual beliefs, that when you sort of start like looking at it a bit closer, it doesn't make any sense.
In what way? Go on and explain. I mean, I think for me, just to put it into some kind of context, I would imagine that my understanding of the food chain is, you know, that kind of picture that you see in primary school where you have a beetle and then a mouse and then what would eat a mouse?
a fox.
Yeah,
a fox or a bird.
Yeah, some kind of bird and then a fox and, you know, and then a tiger, yeah. And then man at the top of it going.
That's what it is. It's very vague, and it's very kind of like we remember it from childhood, we remember it as growing up, there is this food chain. And what I've found through investigation and sort of like assistance from friends is that my perception is that it's kind of like there's this ecosystem that we're part of, and you know, we eat plants and animals, and then they biodegrade, and there's this sort of balance going on, and that's why we need to eat animals and plants. That was the idea that sort of got presented to me. And as a child, I never really looked at those steps. Do you know what I mean? It was like the plants, then the bugs eat the plants, and then, but already you got stuck because it's like, well, what eats the rats? What eats the mice? You know what I mean? And then why are we only eating the cows and the pigs and the sheep?
Yeah.
Do you mean, and the reality is the majority of them, apart from the chickens, the majority of the animals that we eat only eat plants, herbivores.
Right, yeah.
And it doesn't make sense and is completely false on many levels. The one level is that, like, we eat these other animals and that, you know, that by doing this we maintain an ecological balance. But the reality is that we don't have an ecological balance.
No, the
right now.
narrative actually just seems to have built an artificial hierarchy that puts us at the top, and therefore we can have dominion over all the plants and animals.
Absolutely, and the reality is that that's a choice. Do you know what I mean? We can either choose to kill all these animals and eat all the plants, or we choose to eat the plants. It's this false myth that's been generated. And the reality is that this is kind of like a comical side to it. I've never seen any of those illustrations of a food chain. So when people say to me that the food chain exists, I always ask them for an illustration of it, like the one you were describing. Because all the ones I've seen don't make any sense and just look ludicrous. But the reality is that the one word that just destroys it all is the word supermarket. And what I mean by that is there's no diagram, and there never will be a diagram that involves the mole, the vole, or the mouse eats the grass, and then the fox eats the mouse, and then the human goes to the supermarket. Do you know what I mean? Like that's it's a whole it's an illusion. It's an absolute illusion because we don't keep an ecological balance, and like we've discussed many times, that animal agriculture is tipping it in the complete opposite way of maintaining an ecological balance. And we use a supermarket. We're not part of a food chain. We're part of a human constructed supermarket, buy food from a shop chain. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for sure.
And so I suppose I'm one of those people that wants to educate people about these myths, because we have so many of these myths perpetuating society and our lives that we need to start questioning. And then when somebody, another one is the circle of life, which is very similar, and the similarities is that it's completely illogical and false. It's kind of like it's not the reality is it is not the circle of life if you're involving killing animals. And also it's show me I want to see I would love to see data on the circle of life, because I don't believe it actually exists. I think it's another myth that we've perpetuated and sort of put out there.
So outline what the narrative of the circle of life is.
Well, I suppose it's like I'd be honest. All I really know is that my narrative just comes from the, or my understanding or any knowledge really comes from the Lion King. Do you know what I mean? That's the time I ever really heard it. But what is it's a mythical kind of idea. Do you know what I mean? I mean, you could just say, we could just create it today. We could create the circle of not killing, and then we create this idea, this way of living that just doesn't kill. Do you know what I mean? That's literally how it's, from my perspective, that's how it's appeared. I don't see any evidence of a circle of life.
Right, okay,
And
yeah. I mean, to be honest, it's something that apart from a phrase that I've probably heard without really thinking about too deeply, I have no understanding of what the phrase "circle of life" means. I mean, it may as well be meaningless. I've never seen The Lion King.
oh, okay. So basically, the circle of life is it's a long time since I saw it, but it's about lions in the wilderness of South Africa. But the reality is that we need some proof of it. Do you know what I mean? People can't just say. What happens is that a lot of people I know have used the circle of life. They don't know what it means, but they've used it as an excuse to carry on eating animals.
Right, yes, okay, yeah, I get that for sure.
Similarly, you've got.
Any kind of, I mean, I think because we've discussed this before, people have a certain degree of cognitive dissonance when it comes to eating animals, and so you will clutch at anything, whether it's true or not, as long as it supports your narrative and
Exactly,
allows you
yeah.
to justify your actions, even if there's actually no truth in it. And
Yeah,
we see it all the time, not just in meat eating, all kinds of
facets of life,
facets of life, yeah, use these kind of.
the kind of like, so I've created a set of responses to these points. So when people say food chain, I say, can you show me some data, and where does the supermarket included in this? And when people say things like, I need meat for protein, I ask them how much protein a human being needs. And I also ask them if they know what an amino acid is. And the majority of people I've spoken to, they don't know that human beings need around 56 grams of protein a day. And they also don't know that all fruits and vegetables have amino acids, and those amino acids turn into building blocks and make the protein we need in our diets. So we've got these, because I'm guilty of it too. We have these knee-jerk responses, these things that allow us to maintain our current beliefs. And I mean, at its core, the reality is that animal products do taste nice. And so people don't want to admit that the things that they enjoy involve causing suffering to animals. And you know, the harsh reality is that we're talking about life and death for these animals. But a cognitive dissonance, like a coping mechanism, is to create these false beliefs.
Right,
And I
okay.
suppose, does that sort of link up? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so it's not that these people are, and the other thing is, like, you know, the circle of life or the food chain or whatever myth or idea that comes up, or the protein myth, these are things that have been passed on, you know what I mean? It's not like we're generating these ourselves. It's ideas that have been passed on to us, and until we break them down and
It's
see
as
how
you said
valid they
before,
are.
they're kind of old-fashioned narratives, aren't they, that have been passed down, and they just perpetuate the status quo, and everybody takes it as read without really thinking about it too deeply. Partly because they don't have to, but partly because for a lot of people it justifies their behaviour, or it supports their behaviour.
The reality is that for some people believe that it's more complicated and a lot harder to be to take animal products out. That was my belief, and that's a lot of people's belief. So people want an easy life in general. So they're like, it's easier for me to not think about where this milk has come from and how many animals were killed in the process of making a burger, or the actual the full extent of the process.
Yeah.
And so the reality is, I couldn't keep lying to myself as an individual. I couldn't. I was like, I don't like the fact, I don't want to be a part of a system that kills animals for food when we don't need to. So that's why I sort of was like, logically, as a sort of rational human being, I was like, well, I can either go down road A, which I've been on for 25 years, which means that I think a lot less and I don't really think about what's going on in my body, or I take road B, which causes a lot less suffering and harm, and actually, you know, I wouldn't kill any of the animals that I eat. So why, you know, why am I doing that? Why, what would, what does it, it doesn't make any sense to me. And so, but it takes sort of retrospective, it takes some honesty with yourself as individuals to look closely at what we're a part of and be like, okay, so I can either spend my time and energy contributing to this, or I take myself out of the system and become one less consumer and one less person who can contribute to supply and demand. And it gives people it gives them autonomy, it gives them a sense of power when you realize that you as a consumer, when you buy things, that does have a knock-on effect.
I think, yeah, and I mean, talking about the knock-on effect, I mean, I think what we can take from this, I think, is very positive, is that a lot of the way that people consume meat is embedded within our society culturally, and within these little groups within society, there might be people who are contemplating becoming a vegetarian or becoming a vegan, and they don't feel comfortable in that because these traditional narratives are being upheld within their social group. But the wider prevalence and the slow and steady rise in the number of vegans and vegetarians makes it easier for people to start questioning these narratives within their own social circles.
Yeah, I mean, the majority of people have got phones now or access to the internet. And so when you get the protein question, you just literally go and Google. Well, it's actually even more simpler than that. The reality is you just say plants have protein, and those arguments every time, or those discussions, they come up again and again. Chris, have you heard of Earthling Ed?
No, tell me about Earthling Ed.
So Earthling Ed is a public speaker and a YouTuber, and he makes documentaries. But also he's very, very smart, very intelligent, and very productive in what he does. And he's created, on his website, he has created a book. And also on my blog, if you type in Earthling Ed 30 questions. So there's lots of recurring questions that get presented to vegans. Like I've said about protein or the circle of life and the food chain. And there's others like vegans cause more harm than meat eaters, and all these things that have answers.
Yep.
And he's created a booklet, a free ebook that answers all these questions. On top of that, someone I know has created a breakdown of those, so it's a bit more like bite-sized and a bit more easier to consume, of all those top 30, the most common 30 questions that get asked, and how to respond to them. A lot of the time people do the knee-jerk question without knowing what the basis of what they're talking about it is. So as I said about protein, people don't know what amino acids are, but they're asking or making comments about protein.
Right, yes, for sure.
And the reality, so for some people, I'm saying these very quickly and offhand because I've learned them over the last sort of 10 years, but once you start learning them, they don't leave you. So it's not as confusing as it might seem.
Right, yes. So, I mean, yeah, you said that essentially it all boils down to a very small number of questions, all of which have got very clear answers.
Absolutely. And on top of that, what you can do as individuals is you then add your own answers to those questions. So I've made whole talks on confidence and how to talk to people about veganism and sort of the answers to all the questions you get. But also within that, I always advocate that people develop, if they don't like the way that I answer questions, sort of form your own basis and your own way of describing them.
Right, yeah.
Because sometimes I may come across in a way that people don't want. They're like, I don't like that line of talking, but that's fine. You don't have to say exactly what I say. Individuals can form their own thinking, their own answers, but based on those same information.
Yeah.
Because there's that old adage, is kind of like,
the underlying facts behind the statements doesn't change. It's just the way that people want to present it. And people might want to hear it in a different way.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, you present
or,
it and...
Yeah,
and,
make it more palatable depending on the audience.
Exactly, yeah. And also you can control how long you discuss about it. So if you want to go into the intricacies of the food chain and the fact that it's, you know, talk about supermarkets and which data, etc. Or you just say supermarkets, I don't think... There is no food chain, it doesn't exist. And similarly with protein, you can talk about it, or you just say plants have protein.
Right, yeah, for sure.
Would you like to play another track?
Yeah, let's do that. Where should we go?
Let's go for the Libertines track.
Can't Stand Me Now. Why did you choose that?
I don't know, it just... I just really like the song, and it just reminded me of a really fun time of my life.
Okay, cool. Let's play that then. We can dedicate it to Tony. He likes the Libertines, doesn't he?
Okay, awesome.
Was Can't Stand Me Now, which was the Libertines, chosen by Bertie Justice here on Vegan 123, Sound Up Radio 102.5 FM. We're going to keep talking. Bertie.
Hey, Chris. Yeah, so one thing that's jumped out at me is sustainability. And there's often a notion that as vegans who buy soya products, soya gets bad rap because of its association with deforestation in especially places like the Amazon and other parts of the world. But interestingly enough, soya is that can actually be grown in Europe. I don't know if you knew that, Chris.
I don't know if I did. I mean, I noticed the other day that I found very exciting. Somebody mentioned to me that chickpeas can be grown in the UK, but I have no
idea. Oh, nice.
Hey?
I said nice.
Yeah, but I mean, as we were just sort of discussing briefly while that track was playing, I've got no idea, you know, what the volumes are, what the yield is, the efficiency of it all. But yeah, going back to soya as well, I mean, it gets a bad rap, doesn't it? Because predominantly, well, not predominantly, but a lot of the soya that's grown and a lot of soya that is held up or used to attack the industry, as it were, in these claims of deforestation is grown as animal feed, surely.
Absolutely. Yeah, the reality is that this very nicely links to avocados. So the reality is, well, so what I've been presented with before is that avocados are, you know, they're flown from South America to my vegan plate, and all vegans are pushing up that environmental impact. But that completely ignores the reality that the majority of avocados bought in the UK are bought by non-vegans.
Absolutely. So, I thought it was just millennial students to put on toast. That seems to be the common narrative.
But it's not, though. Who's doing these surveys where they're counting, they're going, when you buy an avocado, I've never been asked where I bought my avocado from. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's craziness. And so the reality is that when people talk about, say, they say, oh, it's very strange. So veganism is a philosophy and way of living which seeks to exclude animal products to help animals, so we cause less suffering. But within that, you get put under the microscope of, oh no, but you can't be a vegan because your unenvironmental food choices of buying an avocado from South America. We're human beings and we're adults, the majority of people who buy food. You turn over the avocado, and if it says South America, don't buy it from there. You can buy them from Europe. You can buy them from the Middle East, which is will have a shorter footprint. And as you say, soya gets a lot of bad rap because vegans are contributing to deforestation. The reality is that all food, if it wasn't naturally grown there, we have to destroy the land. Do you know what I mean? Whatever was there, whatever food. The majority of the fields in the UK weren't those fields before, so that is a form of deforestation. It's changing the land.
Yeah, for sure. Dartmoor used to be forest.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, and there's, you know, there's every city didn't used to be a city. You know what I mean? So human beings destroy land, not just vegans, for their soya products. But the reality is that the largest contributor to deforestation in the Amazon is animal agriculture, and is the soybeans that are grown to feed to these cows, and also some of that soy is fed to the cows in the UK. So yes, let's have a discussion about soya or environmental impacts of our food, but we have to assess what's on our plates at the same time as while sort of observing vegans.
Yeah, for sure.
And the one that always jumps out at me is that most animal products, so there's a website called waterfootprint.org, and you can track how much water is used for the products that you consume.
What, so that waterfootprint.org?
Yeah. So you can pull up some oats, or you can pull up some chicken, or you can pull up some bread, or whatever. There's a food gallery that you can flick through. And that the reality is it's not just the fact that it came on a plane, it's how much resources go into it.
So what's really sort of caught your eye as a bit shocking on this website?
Not necessarily shocking, it's just like the fact that a lot of animal products take a lot more water.
Yes, of course.
And because the majority of the animals that we eat food that is needed water as well.
Yeah, so you're using the water to grow the crops, and obviously the animals are drinking water as well.
Yeah, I mean, it gets really crazy because we have like water bans in the UK, and there's like water bans in California, and blueberries get like complained about because almonds, that's it. Almonds use a lot of water, but almonds don't use as much water as a cow does. And so it's a weird way of thinking that you just focus on how negative a vegan product is without assessing what's on your own plate at the same time.
Yeah.
We have to honestly like hold ourselves accountable. If we're going to talk about other people, we have to be honest and accountable for what we're doing at the same time.
Yeah, so I mean, it's deeply political, isn't it, in that obviously you've got, going back to what we were talking about when the programme first started, vested interests who would like to discredit vegan vegetarian diets as much as possible without outright saying don't eat vegetables, which obviously they wouldn't want to say.
But the reality is that my belief is that human beings will wake up gradually, and they'll start, like I said, the analogy of the burning house, the roof's on fire, the first floor's on fire, you're sitting in the middle of the house, and you're like, what do I do? Okay, let's eat another burger and just burn another forest. You know what I mean? It's like, no, you wouldn't. You would assess what you're eating and the environmental impact of what we're eating. And yeah, there will be people who are going to be against the change because there's a monetary gain at the core of it.
Yeah, it's funny you said that. It reminds me, you must have seen the This Is Fine meme of a dog sitting in the middle of a burning room on a chair.
No, I haven't seen that one, no.
Oh, I'll forward it to you. But yes, it just put that image into my head that people will just ignore some of the most obvious circumstances, rather than try to do anything about it.
Well, I mean, something that jumps out at me is the whole do you remember the horse meat scandal?
Yes, of course.
And so a lot of people in the UK were outraged that there was horse in their in whatever their pie or whatever. But the reality is there's not a lot different than a cow than a biologically between a horse and a cow. They're both mammals. They're both. Do you know what I mean? They're both herbivorous. They're both.
No, for sure. And I mean, I think what a lot of the outrage was probably down to the fact that it was out in the open, because it had probably been happening for years. And, you know, horse meat is always made up, you know, part of animal food and things like that, so.
I suppose what we need to do is make that association that these are animals and not just like beef or bacon or whatever.
Yeah, this is very distinct, isn't it, between food animals, work animals and pet animals.
Yeah. Animals is jumping out at me now, so I think this is a good time to play All About the Animals.
Ah, cool. Yes.
Oh, while you're trying to set it up, I'll just give a little overview of what it is.
Yep, go on.
So basically, I enjoy beatboxing to myself, sometimes in the shower, sometimes when I'm going for a run. And what I found is A, that I enjoy it, and B, within that, I can also do some okay impressions of animals.
Okay, looking forward to this.
And then one of my friends, I'm going to call him DS, he's a legend and he's in Australia at the moment. He is a really talented musician. And so I went to his house, and the first time I'd ever been in a recording studio, and I cried with laughter. Because what you'll hear in a minute is lots of all the vocals and beatboxing is all done by me, and then the guitar is obviously done by a guitar. But while I'm doing it, I'm there like headphones on, beatboxing into a microphone, and then we're developing my ability to do impressions of cows and pigeons and stuff like that. So I'm listening to my impression of a pigeon really loud, like I've never heard it before, and I just started laughing and crying so hard. I don't. Have you made much music, Chris?
Bits and pieces over the years, but yeah, probably nothing like this.
Have you ever laughed while you're making it?
Probably, maybe not for those reasons.
But yeah, and then because veganism is so broad in that it's great for animals, it's great for the environment, and it's great for human health, I always like to bring it. I'm interested in all those other areas, but I always like to bring it back to the animals, because they're the biggest element of it for me, and they're the reason that we should all be doing it. And so that's why it's titled All About the Animals.
So shall we play it?
Yeah, let's do it.
Cool. Okay, this is, yeah, Bertie Justice, all about the, oh, excuse me, all about the animals.
Ranch. Now I'm going to show you how to make one of the most effective breaks of all.
There we go. Bertie, nice little video there as well with you feeding some goats at the end. Or a little Shetland.
Yeah. So I think I gave you the extended version of it. But yeah, that's... what did you think?
It was great. I loved it. Is that up on your on the website?
Yeah, so it's on my YouTube. If you go, it's on my YouTube website, and then also, yeah, you'll be able to see. So I just sent you the video that a compilation of me visiting animal sanctuaries.
So, right, is that what that is?
Yeah. So all those animals they live their lives on sanctuaries now.
Ah, okay, cool.
Yeah, so it is literally all about the animals.
Nice. They're all in the UK, are they?
Yes. Yeah.
Wicked. So if you want to see the video that we're talking about, because of course this is radio, you can go and check out Bertie's website, which is www.bertiejustice.co.uk.
Yeah, so that's my website, and then the video will be on Bertie Justice on YouTube.
Which is what? Call Bertie Justice.
If you just type Bertie Justice, the full title is The Waking Up Process, Bertie Justice.
Okay, cool. And if people go there, they can see you talking about all kinds of stuff, vegan and veganism.
Yeah, I mean, like we've got this lovely opportunity now to spend an hour and a half discussing, or however long we do today. But then all these other topics that I've talked about in the past, you know, there's so much information out there. There's so many things to talk about. And so, yeah, the having the YouTube and the website allows me to, the people can access it every day at any point.
Yeah, which is cool. Is there anything coming up on the vegan calendar? Because obviously there's still no Veg Fest, no vegan fair in Bristol.
No, so I'm keeping an eye out for Christmas fairs.
Right, okay.
So Christmas fairs often have vegan food stalls with them.
Okay.
So there is talk of Totnes having a festival. And also I will try and have a look. So basically I also volunteer with Exeter Friends for Animals.
Uh-huh.
And they have a market, and we used to have a market once every 2 months. So that's a vegan market once every 2 months in the Corn Exchange.
In Exeter.
Yeah, and obviously everything's changed at the moment, but there is talk of a Christmas fair or a January fair.
Okay.
What we'll have to do, there is also, if for those interested, VegFest. So VegFest is a huge festival in the UK, for those that don't know. And if you follow their Facebook and their website, they are having online festivals at the moment.
Okay. I didn't know that.
So you can go and see other speakers and check out the stalls and that kind of thing.
Right. A really good way to find out information, but not such a good way to have a crafty nibble of the latest vegan snacks.
No.
Sadly.
But what I've realised is that, I think I've mentioned it before, but there's so many... websites out there that have amazing recipes. And this is quite a nice link, actually. So in January, have you ever heard of Veganuary, Chris?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, so for those that haven't heard of what Veganuary is, what it is we have this sort of tradition of having a sort of a challenge in January of the year. You know, we either do we start going sober, or you do some exercise, or those kind of things. So Veganuary is a vegan challenge for the month. Do you do the month of January vegan? And what they've presented, you go to Veganuary and you can use their website for recipes, eating guides, and also like they have lots of like helpful packs and those kind of things. So lots of help if you are interested in doing Veganuary.
Okay, that's definitely relevant. We shall mention that again in 4 weeks' time as we get closer.
Yeah. And it's I do always talk about Veganuary because the website has got amazing dishes and that kind of thing. So the reason I'm saying that is for those that can't get to the vegan fairs or the vegan markets, is that you can use Veganuary website and then try and experiment with some at-home meals.
Yep, new recipes, things you haven't tried before, inspiration.
Yeah, I mean, I've made a lot of recipes over the years, but I'm still finding these new ones. So, like, I've never made an azuki bean burger. I've never made a apple and pear rosti. Do you know what I mean? There's
Yeah, I mean, I think this, this is a useful resource. I think anybody who cooks, you can get stuck in a rut, can't you? Or you can just keep treading the same familiar cooking path. So, yeah, use it as a source of inspiration to try out something new.
tell you what I did have. I don't know if I mentioned it last time. Have you heard of toefish?
Sorry, is that toad fish or toe fish?
Toefish. So it's a vegan fish and chips.
Oh, right, like toffee based.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what they did is they wrapped some tofu in seaweed.
Then fry it in batter.
Yeah. So I had that up in Wollacombe, and it was amazing. It was amazing. There's also banana blossom. I don't know if you've heard of that, Chris. You can use banana blossom to make vegan fish and chips as well.
I didn't know about the banana blossom. No, I went to I was lucky enough to go to Newcastle a few years ago with another good friend of mine, another vegan friend of mine, in fact two vegan friends of mine, and we sampled a lot of the vegan delights in Newcastle. So we went to the same cafe twice for breakfast in the centre of town, but we also went to a vegan pub in Newcastle,
A vegan pub.
which was a really cool thing. Yeah, vegan pub. So yeah, everything vegan, beers, vegan foods,
Oh, wow.
proper pub, very popular. And yeah, one of our party had vegan fish and chips, and it was exactly that. It was tofu, marinated tofu wrapped in seaweed and batter, and then deep fried, served on a plate with chips and salad. Absolutely amazing. I can't remember what the pub is called, but it was banging. Shout out to Newcastle. Love you.
The thing is, I think I've mentioned it before, but Happy Cow, if we type in Newcastle now into Happy Cow, it'll get all the listings of places that are either vegan or have vegetarian options or like whole food shops.
Yeah, you've mentioned Happy Cow before. What a great website that is.
Yeah, it's just a very helpful website. Should we put on
It's
another
called
track, Chris?
the Ship Inn. I just thought I'd quickly Google it.
Which part of Newcastle is it in?
It's in Stepney Bank, and it
Okay, cool.
opens at lunchtime. Yeah, I'm sure everybody veggie in Newcastle knows all about it. Ah, yeah, there we go, and it's on happycow.net as well. 10 best vegan restaurants in Newcastle upon Tyne. Which, to be honest, isn't particularly relevant to us down here in sunny southwest Devon, but there you go.
No, but the reality is that, I was up in Wollacombe and I had that vegan fish and chips, but it just shows that it's everywhere.
That's it. And if you're travelling around, Happy Cow, what a great resource, because you never know where you're going to end up. And if you do want to go and find that and support that vegan hostelry, there's your resource for it.
Should we play another track, Chris?
Yeah, I think we should wind it up, mate, and
Not a problem.
get back onto this in a few weeks' time. It's been really lovely talking to you this morning on Vegan 123.
No problem at all. Yeah, thanks for having me as ever.
Well, it's your show, mate. Really, I'm just pushing the buttons.
That's cool.
What should we
Hold.
watch?
I was going to go for Hold Your Breath.
Ah, the Etherwood track. Excellent. Okay, we shall do that. Thank you very much for listening. You've been listening to Vegan 123, your host, Bertie Vegan Justice, currently today on the telephone, live from Newton Abbot. Me in a home studio here in Buckfastleigh, going out 102.5 to Totnes and Dartington, around the world on the web stream, sound.radio.org.uk/listen. Thank you so much for listening.